I now request Professor S.K. Tripathi to honor the chairman and reporter for this session. Yeah. Okay.
Very good afternoon and welcome after a nice tea. This is the first serious business of first technical session. In this, there are two lead lectures are there, one by Professor Hazarika, the other by Professor Das, followed by four presentation as announced. Both these lead lectures, 30 minutes are allotted, and the remaining four persons, they get 10 minutes. So in doing so, you please see that instead of giving introduction, spending time on all those things, introduction, general information, what exactly you want to say, that only in 10 minutes you should try to project, because the time is a constraint here. With this brief remark, I request Professor Hazarika to come and occupy the seat. Let me very briefly introduce Professor Hazarika. Professor Hazarika is the former director of Assam Agriculture Research Institute. Please take your seat there. Former director Agriculture Research Institute. He joined as a junior technical geneticist. It's a very junior post, but he ended up, by the time he retired, he ended up as the director. He did his MSc from again Assam Agriculture University, and MSc from Punjab University, Lahore, and PhD from Haryana. And postdoc, he has also worked in NI Vavilov Institute in Moscow, where I was also there for some time. So that's a very wonderful institute. I think all agricultural scientists should visit that. And his field of specialization is genetics. And so far, he has published 65 papers in the national and international journals, and also brought out three new rice varieties and two pulse varieties and three oilseed varieties. I think that's very creditable for any agriculture scientist. He has also received some awards, fellow of Indian Society of Genetics and Plant Breeding. That's one very important. With this few very brief remarks, I welcome Professor Hazarika to deliver his lecture, and I am also keen to sit and see. Thank you. Hi, Hazarika.
A very good afternoon. Most respected and our esteemed guest, Chairman Dr. Rao, and esteemed participants. I think lot many scientists from different institutes are here. Then students, teachers, and ladies and gentlemen. So at the outset, I must express one thing. I have already heard the lecture of Dr. Rao. And after hearing Dr. Rao, it appears that other presentation will be just complementary or supplementary of life. He has already covered many things. And from agriculture university, generally we mostly go for practical things. As you have seen, you have heard, basically I'm a geneticist. I have done work in pulses mainly, then oilseed also. But we had that aromatic plant scheme, MAP schemes, and we have done something. And in the very beginning, I would like to say that the product development, what Dr. Rao is emphasis, is very important. But it's not easy task. So in Assam Agriculture University, we have developed one product. But for that product, we have to run from pillar to post. Because that for identification of active ingredient is very difficult. We have to find out some animal scientist for testing it. So many difficult. And it involves a lot many money. So see, in government policy should be there. Government policy should be there. We should help the scientist. The scientists also, they are helpless. Many times they submit projects. I discussed with Dr. Mao, I think. He also agreed. He has submitted one project, I think 40, 50 crore. But nobody is interested to give the fund. So this is a mismatching. This is a real situation, actually. But anyway, before going to my lecture, I must thank Dr. Tripathi, actually, for a number of reasons for that. First, he has organized this one in this remote corner. And another important thing, he's from Department of Forestry, which is very important. Many a times, Forest Department is very important for us. The medicinal plant, I don't know whose material it is, who is responsible for that. Agriculture universities, I have seen, mostly they are interested for cereals, pulses, oilseeds, horticulture crops, food crops like that, vegetables. So this time I have, I thank Tripathi also for organizing this very important seminar. And because this is very important, and any number of seminars or awareness program is less, especially in this season. And I also thank Tripathi for inviting me, and also thank Tripathi for inviting Das, like that, Saha is there, Rao is there. So even if the number is here less, but I have seen all effective lectures will be delivered. And I am also hopeful that some very good resolution will be taken and proceeding will be good. And it should be sent to different funding agencies also. Ministry of Ayush also taking some programs now. So with this word, I'll start my seminar. I'll try to finish early because I have to case my flight also there in Jorhat. I have a meeting tomorrow, very urgent meeting. So I'll finish it up. I'll skip some slides if necessary. So this is the topic. His prospects and constraints of commercialization of medicinal plant. What is Dr. Rao's main theme, commercialization. So that's why it is a red mark. It's very difficult and it should be the prime importance. Maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 products, but we should go for commercialization. Next. So this is a map. Old Assam map, Northeast Mist map. See here, scope is there, everybody knows the scope, but what is my intention is to show this map is there. This biodiversity is there, and this biodiversity reason is that there's a free exchange. From time immemorial, there's a free exchange of materials. So I do not know how many of you know. This region, Assam, is connected with all these eastern countries before independence, by road, by rail, and by ship, by water. But just after independence, because of some security reason, all roads, all connections are stopped. And because of that reason, the Northeast region is still, we are behind. At the time of independence, our growth is much better than all India level, but it is now very low. So now again, government has realized this very lately, and they have opened a steel shore road, and they are also trying to open this corridor. And I'm hopeful that if this will open, it will give a very boost for our farmers, for our entrepreneurs. And see, our distance from Assam to Guwahati to Delhi or Bombay is far, far more than what is the distance between your Imphal and other many good cities or capitals of the countries, nearby countries. So this is my intention. So this is what I have done. Prioritize. Dr. Rao has also emphasis. Assam is divided in 6 agroclimatic zones. This is Lower Brahmaputra Valley, then Central Brahmaputra Valley Zone, Upper Brahmaputra Valley Zone, Hill Zone, North Plain Zone, and Barak Valley. So these clear-cut zones are there, depending upon the climate, depending upon the soil. And we have prioritized some medicinal plant. And see, some plants, suppose in Hill Zone, you'll only see one, Kapur Kasri. It is a nearby Nagaland area. So this particular zone, we have research stations, regional research station in all the zones, and we are giving emphasis on in particular crops in particular zone. In particular, so one zone consists of 5-6 districts, we are concentrating on that. Developing agro techniques also, many times agro techniques are not there, we are doing it. Another, this one, around 29 we have. So we are trying to, that job we have completed. This is another important thing, we have to analyze it. This is the current status and possible action for improving our medicinal plant practices. Then contribution of forestry. I just earlier informed. The forestry department, they do not know. Their main emphasis is for guarding the animals, the forestry. They know little about the medicinal aromatic plants, but our treasure there in the forest department. So I think all this trade of medicinal plant, role of agriculture, see, I'm from agriculture universities, but we do very little less work, or little work. Not only our agriculture university, most of the agriculture university, they're more interested for your cereals, pulses, and other crops. And it's specifically true also, government also giving more emphasis on those crops. Within the agriculture, You see, if you think rice and cereal, suppose, and pulses, I don't know how many of you know, that we spend much more money, 5 million tons of pulses we generally procure from other countries every year. Even though our area in pulses are more, our production is more, but our people, they like pulses. And see, Dr. Rao has already mentioned that USA, Russia, so they have come into the picture. Now America, Canada, USA, Australia, they are producing pulses and they are sending to us. So same, similar to your medicinal aromatic plants. We need pulses, but we produce less. We need more. So other countries are coming up. So same thing in medicinal plants also. Within a very short time, the other country will keep an eye, and definitely they will take still, and they make so many good, they have good laboratories are there, they can create the environment. What environment these plants is growing in Northeast, they can create it, and they can produce those plants. We cannot say. See, even this basmati rice is stolen, see? India had to fight international court for GI of basmati. So this is the condition. So all this, maybe we can, the topic of seminar. All this can be a topic of seminar. We can invite these forestry people. We can invite different organizations. We can, R&D also, different institutes are there. In each, I think this, each topic can be a topic of a seminar. So this is not nothing more. This is only number. I think Dr. Ra has given the third prayer, the destructive harvesting. And this is very important. It is day by day, it is dwindling, that means biodiversity. It is reducing. So these are some reasons why it is a small land holding. Gap between the low quantity production and high demand. People are producing. But if you want that, I need a truck, two truck load of medicinal plant, nobody can supply. And this is happening in our Assam. This Patanjali has recently, they have established one factory there. And they want a lot many things, but we cannot supply it. So they are importing from other places. So in good planting material like seed. So even good rice seed, good pulses we cannot provide. Forget about the medicinal plant. And unless and until good planting material will be there, you cannot think of commercialization. Then industrial point is there. Market is also a problem. Transportation, same thing. Because we do not have here any factory here. We have to collect the raw material. We have to send to Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta. And so this is, again, important cost of transportation. And this is the exploration of plants from wild source, already mentioned. So this is sane. In Assam, generally, we have seen this one, this way. This first gatherer and cultivator, they will give to local agencies, they go over state agencies, then they go suppliers, then wholesalers like that. Same thing, villagers, they employ laborers, the agent is there. So this is the same. Disposal chain or marketing chain, what is going on now? This is another important thing, it's legalized procurement, which is available in Jharkhand. In Jharkhand, there's official system is there, and the collectors and their agent deliver the collection center to Virasang. Virasang is there. So that type of facility not existed in the Northeast. So I think that is very important for commercialization, and is insufficient in the existing supply chain with compared to competitive market. Also demands some regulatory bodies. So we need an in-depth analysis for that. And see, in other communities we have mandi. The auction center is there. But that type of mandi and auction center exclusive for medicinal is not there. So definitely, if you can try, you can start that mandis. Then taking a medicinal plant as one of the value-added crops. Nowadays, we talk about value addition. If you to grow rice, no value. But if you can produce muri out of that, chira out of that, it will value added. So we are going for value addition for many other crops, but still it is far, far, it means, away from the medicinal plants. And the role of middleman, is there. So this is another point. So what is the immediate needs? So including and modernizing the production of medicinal plants in a rather sustainable way, Dr. Rao already told. This conservation means we have not to destroy it, but we have to develop it. Establishing information network among all relevant institutes, government, non-government organizations. And reinforcing the cooperation and communication among the officials, farming community, forest dwellers, entrepreneurs. So these are some challenges. I have given 6 challenges. First one is motivation to farmers. This is a good challenge, so we have to take up different departments, we have to take different challenges. The creation of marketing facility, then sustainable use, conservation, that means proper identification of plants and quality planting material, regulatory mechanism, and entrepreneurial development. So how, I do not know how, but these challenges we should meet. So there should be coordination. The State Medicine Plan Board is there, National Medicine Mission for Medicine Plan, then Facilitation Center. I'm happy to announce that Assam Agriculture University, we got one Facilitation Center from Ministry of Ayush with a budget of 1.5 crore for this year. So I am just, my intention of coming to this institute is also to collaborate and make some collaborations. Good fund of so I also discussed with Tripathi how we can make, because the regional center means we have to, all the Northeast states should be included. Then this forest department of the states, then agriculture and horticulture department, then drug testing laboratory, defense research laboratory, Gov IVD colleges, and agriculture and other universities, KVKs, this all, this number, net fee, is all if you can. Cumulatively, if you start something, not alone, separately, if there should be some forum for that, definitely. And NGOs, we cannot go for avoid NGOs also there. So this what is repetition about 70 to 90% in terms of specific species numbers commercially exploited. 50 to 70% in terms of quantity. That means most medicinal plants now will continue to be wild collected. Although we are trying our best for domestication or cultivation, it is coming up very lessly and is limited to particular species, not all. And many times we do not know what agrogenic climate, how they will grow. They are growing in wild form in the hills, in hillocks, in different habitats. And cultivation cannot be the principal solution to our harvesting. This is our mistakes many a times. So then what is the alternative? So make wild collection sustainable. And who has developed good this agronomic agriculture collection practices? So we should follow it. The forest department should encourage it. So industrial demand is there. Mostly we know about herbal formulation many a times. So these herbal-based cosmetics, nowadays you'll get all cosmetics having your medicinal aromatic plants, then nutrition supplements. So nutraceuticals is important, for it is only for students. It is nutrition plus pharmaceuticals. And nowadays from morning to toothpaste to evening your cream, anti, that means aging cream, everywhere you'll get this medicinal aromatic plants. And so this is the definition, a food that has component incorporated into it to give a specific medical and physiological benefit other than purely nutritional benefit. Similarly, a food product other than tobacco that bears vitamin, minerals, herb and other botanicals and amino acids concentrated. So this is the plan, we get food, in one side we can get drugs, then nutraceuticals, then there is a overlapping portion of that. This is a prevention. So nutraceuticals in wheat, gray area between food and drugs. That way it's important. This, we know about the probiotics, prebiotics, that means those food we take because for our bacteria microflora in inside. Omega fatty acid, then dietary fiber, antioxidants. So this is very old data. This is, see how this is increasing. Total export, how it is increasing. I think now it will be many, I think in lakhs, many lakhs. But already Dr. Rao has covered this. All raw materials used by pharmaceutical medicine are not indigenous origin. Many times we think that it is indigenous, but it's not. The Chirata malolization, I think already Dr. Rao has mentioned, is from Nepal and Bhutan. This is also this from Pakistan. Earlier in Gugulu. Then licorice, it's from Afghanistan. And this is Bansalosan, it's from Singapore. Many times we feel that we are rich in bamboo. So many times it says from Singapore. So there's so many other examples are here. So this is again substitution. Actually, Rahulfia is important. Dr. Rao has already mentioned, because of substitution, it is because of not availability or high production cost. So they make changes. It's not availability, high production cost, then also adulteration. Wrong identification, already Dr. Rao has indicated. And man-made variables. So this is again another one. The Plumbago indigo, indica is not available, so it is from Ceylon, this Plumbago, the Linica. It is also that way. Substitution. So non-timber forest products is very important. It is for only forest people. Provide 40% of total forest revenues and 50%, 55% of forest-based employment. And nearly 500 people living in and around forest rely on this NTFP as a critical component for their subsistence. So this is one example. So sal, generally is a term, it is important for timber and gum. But we do not know the value of the seed. So the kernel seed is contains rich in fatty acids, which is low in iodine. Similarly, D-oil meal is protein content is 7.8% to 9%. And is rich in lysine, like your pulses. And this carbohydrates. So we can get that good proteins. Then detoxification, this animal feed, then fertilizer, then industrial starch, many of you do not know. For making tablets, we generally use this maize, generally. But this is a very good substitute for potato and corn for binder ingredients. So in West Bengal government, they are earning more money, lakhs of money. But in Assam, although we are rich in salt, nobody care for this collection of these salt. This is example one. So what we can get from this forest? Another example is this. Humalomina aromatica, it is easily grown anywhere in Assam. So it is for a lot of antifungal, anti-insecticide against. So major constraints for forestry department, the limited knowledge about the innumerable number of medicinal ailment plants. They does not know anything. Then administrative interest only on resources and tourism and timber concern and animal. So attention required to encourage sustainable extraction of NTFP by strictly following good agriculture collection practice. Impose regulatory measures and collections from wild. Develop separate implementation setup, and ultimately, my conclusion is that the mass production through cluster. I think Honorable High Chancellor has indicated this cluster approach, and we should form a triangle. Triangle, to be successful, there should be triangle, farmers, then buyers and financier. So without this triangle, it is not possible. Many NGOs I have seen, they are successful because of this triangle. So cluster approach there, the farmers should get the money, they should get assurance for selling it, and there should be financier. Then regional specific quantity material. So we have different regions, different agroclimatic zones, and according to that, we have to develop this one planting material. Whatever is possible. If it's not possible for hundreds, if it's possible for 5, 10, it's okay. Then managerial and technical skill training. Farmers do not know anything about this skill, how to grow, how to process like that. The semi-processing maintenance of quality, because if you cannot process a little bit in the early, the quality may deteriorate. So that type of is not available. Then storage to overcome market fluctuations. Otherwise, farmers won't get a price for that. Storage is a problem everywhere. If you grow more onion, this is a glut. If you grow more rice, also glut. If you grow more pulses, price is less. So more production in India is a problem. This year there will be more price, next year again price will be fall. The price fluctuation is very difficult. Then organic good agriculture production technology, although it is available in some places, in some crops it is not available. The alternative marketing facilities should be there. Then better transportation facilities. Then promotion through small to medium scale industrial policy. Policy is very important. Many a times we feel that in India, right policy is not there. So because of that, we cannot get the, we cannot harvest our potentialities. And emphasis of endemic species, regional species, and the vibrant R&D facility, which is not there. So I think with this, I conclude. I think I have finished in right time. It's going to be one. So if some questions I can hurriedly address, so I leave to the mic to chairman. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Now, may I request our second invited speaker of the technical session, Professor A.P. Das.
Dr. A.P.
So, thank you, Dr. Rao. My association with Dr. Rao is very, very old. So, I don't like to remember that now. But, yes, I'm a traditional taxonomist. And my taxonomy life started before my schooling. From my childhood, I was a taxonomist. And I like to die as a taxonomist. I am not running behind molecules. And I don't think just molecule-based classifications can replace the basic classifications by Hooker's classifications or Cronquist classifications. These are much better classifications than your presently APG3, APG4, classification. I don't like this classification, frankly speaking. Now, you see, this lecture is not for the senior scientists, frankly speaking. This is not for senior scientists. I think students will be benefited more because basically I'm a teacher. I'm teaching for more than 42 years. So basically I'm a teacher. So this will be mainly for, and again, my main aim is the conservation. I'm very hardcore conservationist. So my aim is conservation. Conservation, if you like to conserve medicinal plants, if you like to conserve medicinal plants, then you have to conserve them in their habitat. And for habitat conservation, you cannot conserve only medicinal plant, you have to conserve everything. Unless you conserve everything, you cannot conserve just one or two your important, medicinally important species. So that is the thing. Why so much sound? Oh, rain. Acha. So looking to that, I prepared one lecture for this. This is Siang River, Arunachal Pradesh, and in Assam it is Brahmaputra. So I like to start with this quotation. I don't understand why when we destroy something, when destroy something created by man, we call it vandalism. But when we destroy something created by nature, we call it progress. Really, I don't understand. For me, construction of this auditorium is one destruction. Destruction of nature. Destruction of the habitat. So my idea is a little bit different. So sometimes I need to face conflict among with many people. So this may be taken as the tentative title of this lecture. The background photograph of Panaxiro ginseng is from high altitude Sikkim. Conservation of East Himalayan flora with emphasis to medicinal plants. This is one overall title. Maybe many times I'll go beyond that. So you are welcome to Eastern Himalaya. See, natural vegetation provide everything for your survival, for the survival of all animals, including man. All animals means it includes man. You cannot exclude man. Or you can exclude other animals, keeping only man. So if man like to survive, then you have to keep surviving all other plants and animals. Otherwise, man cannot survive. You know about the hotspots. IUCN so far recognized 34 hotspots throughout the world. You know, out of these 34, this serial number 13, Himalaya, Indo-Burma, then Sundaland, and Western Ghats and Sri Lanka. So this is Himalaya, this is Indo-Burma, this is Western Ghats and Sri Lanka, and here some part of Andaman Nicobar Island is covered by Sundaland. So these four hotspots are covering in the Indian territory. So that actually proves that why India is considered as one megadiversity country. Out of the only 17 recognized megadiversity country, India is placed quite higher up. So in this area, in our area you see so many, we are thinking about Eastern Himalaya. Now of course this position is not within the Eastern Himalaya hotspot, this is within Indo-Burma hotspot. We are now sitting in Indo-Burma hotspot region, but I'm from this region. This region is Himalaya hotspot region. So in this region, see, this is Himalaya, this is Indo-Burma hotspot, this is mountains of Northeast China hotspot. So many hotspots are accumulated there, covering almost the entire region. That reflects what? That reflects, first, the original biological diversity of this region is huge, very high. At the same time, it also says that the stress on the survival of this biodiversity is very bad status. We are losing our biodiversity every moment. And the main reason is anthropogenic. We are the reason for losing our biodiversity. So this is the Eastern Himalaya region. So this region attracted botanists. Botanists means those who love scientific botany, scientific culture of botany, then plant lovers, plant hunters. Especially during British period, every year 10, 20 shipful of plants were exported to Europe. Every year. So those plants are collected from many regions, including Eastern Himalaya, from South Agastamala, from all these regions. Huge amount of plants were collected and transported to Europe. And now, you will not get many plants here in their natural habitat in Eastern Himalaya or Agastamala, but you will get some of those in the hothouses in Europe. So you have to purchase those materials if you like to work on those plants. That is the situation. We are losing our materials, but other country, they are surviving on those materials. They are making business on those materials. Okay. This is the terai dwarf region.
Terai dwarf region is having contiguous vegetation with Himalayan vegetation, and this vegetation is equally rich, extremely rich. In this region, two rivers are main. There are many rivers, numerous rivers, but two rivers are main: Tista and Brahmaputra. So Tista originated from this Jemu glacier. From that, it came to Chalamu, to Gurdumnar, then from Gurdumnar, Tista took birth. And that Tista became the lifeline of this entire region. But how we are taking care? Now we are constructing a series of dams on Tista. And I cannot spare myself, because from my hand, two such projects have been cleared. Yeah, I consider I'm the faulty person, because I had to clear those dams. But frankly speaking, I was under life threat. Under that situation, I had to clear two dams on Tista. That was the situation. And the Brahmaputra. Brahmaputra originated here, moving in this way. This is the great town. From great town, it entered in India. In Tibet or China, it is called Sangpo. In Arunachal, it is called Siang. In Assam, it is called Brahmaputra. So it is having three names. It is flowing here, and then it merged with the Ganga system. And so finally, Ganga Brahmaputra system forming a great delta, or which the Sundar one has been established. This is Siang River at Pasighat. So most of the regions are insufficiently explored. Remember, most of the regions are insufficiently explored. What are the reasons? Reasons are, first is inaccessibility. Very difficult. At some places, say even in Arunachal, I wanted to visit some places, it was really difficult. Not only distance, but the difficult to approach those places. So, proper fund is not available. See, for molecule-based work, for biotechnological work, there is sufficient funding. But for this type of floristic or explorative work, there is no fund. And these things actually handicap. And the other thing is local expert. We need local expert who will go to such difficult places and will collect materials. And in Northeast, not many foreign groups took interest, though in Sikkim, Bhutan, Nepal, Darjeeling, in this region, many foreign explorers took initiative, but in this region, very few experts took initiative. These are some of the important publications on the flora of this region, and there are some district floras also in addition. The first publication came as early as in 1821. First publication on Eastern Himalaya, it was published by David Don, but not from his own collection. That was some previous collection. Those were accumulated at France. Say, before 1821, those were collected, carried to France. Then David Don studied those materials and published. And after this publication, he got energy. And in 1825, again he published the Prodromus florinepalensis. I think for the entire Eastern Himalaya, that is the first published one flora book. So these publications are so important. So there are other plants like, other books like Rhododendrons of Sikkim Himalaya by Hooker, and the Darjeeling Forest that was published in the second issue of Indian Forester. You know, Indian Forester is so old. It has completed its century long, long back. So Nepal, Bhutan, Eastern Himalaya, these are comparatively better explored. Many scientists from distant region explore this area, and northeastern India is much less explored. We need to give much stress in this area. Main explorers for these states are coming from other states of the country. And BSI played one excellent role. BSI played excellent role in the exploration of Northeast India, that I should agree. But remember, none of these published things are very much complete. We need much more exploration. You see, I came to Arunachal little over 1 year. Within this period, we published a number of new species, number of new distributional records, just within little over 1 year. How is it possible? We are not exploring very distant areas, only some nearby areas, and we are getting new. That means the area is so much underexplored, we need to do it. And if one area is properly explored also, in such area, remember, flora is changing every day. Exotics are entering, interaction between different plants, local environmental changes, so many factors are there. So flora need to be monitored regularly, without which you do not know what material is still there or not there. After 10 years, after the publication of a flora, after 10 years you go there is nothing. Or there are some buildings. That is the condition. Then you need to monitor the flora. Otherwise it will be difficult. We recognize plants mainly by morphology. So if someone new person came to me, how should I recognize him? From his morphology? Or should I take his blood and we'll take the DNA, study the DNA morphology, DNA sequence, so to identify? I think that cannot be the question. Morphotaxonomy should always remain ahead of any other branch of taxonomy. It should be. Otherwise, we cannot run taxonomy. Otherwise, it will be very costly. Those who are afraid of plant science, taxonomy, they opt for molecules, because they cannot work with morphology. They are aware. So they take the help of instruments. What instrument will tell, they will believe it. That is correct or wrong, whatever may be. I am little bit, as Dr. Rao has said, a little bit pro in that way. So this was the first publication. And there are so many other publications during this period within 19th century. Then in 20th century, you see, now some Japanese group is taking some interest. They published the flora of Eastern Himalaya, the enumeration of the flowering plants of Nepal, all these, some interesting books started publishing, publishing from this region. So,
thank you, Professor Das. Now I request you to receive the honors from the chair.
Yes, I front man. Yes. So, yes, good. Okay, madam. Yes. Yes.
Thank you. From here on, the to the notice of speakers and rapporteur, the time limit for the runtime of the speech is restricted to 8 minutes, and an addition of 2 minutes as and when required for the discussion. Thank you.
Very good afternoon to all of you, and respected Chairman Rao sir, and respected rapporteur sir, other dignitaries of the dais, and this is made for the students only. This is not for the senior scientists and teachers, because these are some of the basics in taxonomy. And being a taxonomist, daily what I teach in the class, this I have written down only. And this is not the outcome of my lab, only some observations what I have gathered while my research tenure as well as in teaching. My today's topic is taxonomy and in identification and documentation of medicinal plants. Now the question is, what is taxonomy? We know that this is the ABC of all biological science, because this is the mother. This is the basic of all the other biological science. If we do not know taxonomy, how to name the plants, it's quite impossible to go through these other branches of science. And according to Stace, that the investigation of the causes and consequences of the variation and the usage of the data to produce a system of to produce a stable system of classification, that is the most important outcome of taxonomy, and we do it based upon the similarities.
I think it is, if you skip all this, because you come to the main, because 10 minutes you cannot cover all this,
sir. I will finish.
Yeah, okay.
These are mainly we do it on the basis of similarities and differences, and it deals with the identification, then nomenclature, and finally classification. And this is, we make it in a form of local flora or a regional flora, continental, or the in some cases, now we have the global checklist also. And it helps in the researchers to draw the relationship or the phylogeny between two allied groups. And as we know that this is a synthetic science, it doesn't have any own data. It takes the data from morphology. It can have the data from anatomy, embryology, palynology, whatever it may be. And finally, we are now taking the data from DNA barcoding also. And these are the some floras, monographs, and revisions. We may call these are the conventional way of morphotaxonomic research. And now we are proceeding towards the molecular systematics. Then for medicinal plant research, we can document the medicinal plants in a particular region. Then we can measure the diversity as well as ethnobotanical research. And nowadays, many labs, they are doing the chemical profiling in wet lab as well as computer-aided drug designing. As per the record from BSI, that total spermatophytic plant in India is about 18,465. Out of the 7,263 are considered to be medicinal usage. And out of these, 1,178 are in trade. And these are the, as per Ayush, that these are the plants that are used in different system of medicines in Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, and naturopathy like this. Although that different departments, Government of India, that Ayush, then NMPB, Indian Medicinal Plant Database, BSI, different state biodiversity board, they are doing a lot for to protect, but many people are now also reporting the plants with new medicinal usage as well as the documentation of new medicinal properties of an already known herbal species. So why are people interested in medicinal plant research and cultivation? Number one is it has good prospect. Many scientists are now engaged in CAD, that means computer-aided drug designing, and it has there is a prospect in publication in high-impacted journal, and there is a chance of patenting. Similarly, we cultivate the medicinal plant for these are easy to grow, need less space, provide good returns, demand for export, less chance for infection, and generally not grazed by animals, and can be cultivated easily with other crops. Mainly indigenous plants are being cultivated by the ethnic people, and as we know that northeastern India is the hub of medicinal plants, and I have chalked out some different tribal communities in northeastern states, and from the report of Ministry of Tribal Affairs. And although there are no conflict between the taxonomy and ethnomedicinal research, but there is some lacuna or gap also. That means the lack of proper identification technique studied, and the study is mainly based upon literature survey. Then the lack of cross-cultural study, what sir has already told Rao sir. Then reports mainly based upon single gathering, different land races are not tested for their efficacy, and lack of photographic evidences, and different species known by the same vernacular name often lead to botanical misidentification of species. But how to identify the plant? We should first, after collection, we should go for dissection, but we generally do not go for any dissection. What we do, even my students, they come with a plant and say, what is this? So this should not be the practice. We should first go for dissection, then we can go for preparation of morphotaxonomic description, then we can we have to match this with some standard key, authentic key, then we should match the sample with other authentic specimens and type housed in the herbarium of BSI and the other leading herbarium, then finally we can go for identification. For different web pages can also be studied for the confirmation of the name nomenclature as well as for the identification. These are IPNI, plant list, tropicos, as we all know. I have found, suppose, two and three, same vernacular name, but two different plants. So what happens in the field, if somebody asks the local people, what is this, they say, this is this. Suppose I have collected number 2, but they said the vernacular name for the number 3, then there is a chance of misidentification. So without relying upon the local people, you should go, you should come and dissect the plant, then only the identification, you can expect, okay, this is correct. Then deposition of voucher specimens, there is also some lacking is there. And in publication, we should provide the acronyms and where it has been deposited for the further study. And efficacy must be tested for from different land races to select the best form. Now people are engaged with some wet lab preparation for drug discovery cycle. This is a flow chart for drug discovery cycle. This is the CAD analysis from 10,000 drugs, we can ultimately select only one. So, and this is my last slide, that Bennett et al. Surveyed randomly the titles and abstract of 100 publications. Out of these, 20 publications with taxonomic errors. Number 2, errors generally include in the author citation as well as in misspelled binomial, usage of illegitimate or the synonyms. In some publications, vouchers were designated as types. Therefore, the first and foremost step in the medicinal plant research is the establishment of correct botanical identity by means of taxonomic studies. So this is my humble submission to the students. You go for dissection first, then the procedure what I have said you follow, then only the research on the medicinal plant research or any other research will be fulfilled nicely.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. One thing, he's a very good taxonomist because I have seen his thesis. But I totally differ. You said at some point that taxonomy has no data of its own, but we take from all anatomy, embryology and all that. Please remember, taxonomy is the only subject which has been attacked by all these subjects. Taxonomy has its own data. Today, all the new subjects, newer areas have come, and today we call it chemo, cyto, histo, morpho, molecular taxonometrician. So all this synthetic discipline was not the taxonomy that was born. Taxonomy was the only science and originated. All other subjects have come later. So therefore, taxonomy has its original data, no other data. We do not want embryology, we can do taxonomy. We don't want anatomy, we can do taxonomy. Taxonomy has its own data. So please slightly correct this. Otherwise, thank you so much for the presentation. Any questions?
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, very nice. Good. Rhododendron, eh? Yes, okay. You have worked on rhododendrons.
I am Dr. Kuntal Narayan Chaudhary from Vivekananda College, Kolkata. Sir has already mentioned my title, so I am skipping to the next slide. The use of botanicals for treating human diseases is as ancient as humanity itself. But still, many communities across the world depend on herbal remedies for their primary health care. India has a rich heritage in this respect, and this includes not only the codified classical systems such as Ayurveda or Siddha, but also a lot of local folk traditions. Much of this indigenous traditional knowledge and the medicinal plants associated with them are fast disappearing from India and across the globe. The focus of our study was the peri-urban region, which are former rural areas on the expanding borders of cities. Around Kolkata, much of these areas are facing problems such as destruction of the natural environment, as well as the loss of traditional livelihood, including changes in the social and cultural setups. So the objective of the project of the study was to survey and document the traditional knowledge associated with ethno-medicinal plants in the southwest peri-urban communities of Kolkata. This is a satellite map of Kolkata, and this is the peri-urban region that we had studied, where a lot of semi-urban and urban localities are springing up. The southwest peri-urban region of Kolkata is located in the South 24 Paragonas district, and we studied three semi-urban communities, two of them in the Alupur Sadar subdivision, Sonamukhi and Moynagar, and one in the Diamond Harbor subdivision, which is Puratan Bazar. South Chobbish Porgana is located in the extreme south of West Bengal, just out of the Kolkata district, and these are the three locations that were studied. The initial survey work was done during the pre-monsoon, and post-monsoon seasons. All the authorities and names of plants and families are according to IPNI. A total of 24 inhabitants eight from each locations were interviewed, and their ethnobotanical knowledge was recorded. This include recording the local names of the plants, the paths used, the modes of preparation, the routes of administration of the drugs, as well as the different ailments treated by them. This is a brief profile of the interviewees. Most of them, around 63% of them, were women, and most of them, around 75%, were above the age of 40. These are some of my students interviewing the local women. The result of this survey is briefly presented here. A total of 90 species of vascular plants were recorded, which includes 87 genera and 44 families. The dominant families were Asteraceae and Fabaceae, which are quite common to this region. These and nine other families, that is this total 11, a total of 11 families, represent nearly half of the recorded genera and the species. And we found that most of these plants were herbs, largely terrestrial, and were native to South Asia. This graph shows the distribution of the species among the total 44 families. The most common were in Fabaceae and in Asteraceae. Most of the plants were dicots, a few were monocots. We recorded only one pteridophyte, Marsilia quadrifolia. Most of the plants were herbs, followed by trees, shrubs, and climbers. Most of the plants were terrestrial. There were a few aquatic and semi-aquatic plants, such as Ipomoea aquatica, or water spinach. Although most of the plants are native to South Asia, a sizable amount, that is around 28%, are exotic, mostly naturalized, economically important species. But we also recorded the medicinal uses of two noxious invasive weeds from the New World, from South America, Alternanthera phylloxeroides and Mycenae scandens. Most of the plants, around 60%, were cultivated in this region, usually in agricultural fields along roadside plantations, in home and herbal gardens. Around 40% were collected from the wild, and these three are imported from the Himalayan or from southern India. A plethora of different traditional herbal remedies were recorded. This involved at least 10 different plant paths, around 12 modes of preparation of these drugs, 5 routes of administration of the drugs, and around 51 common medical conditions. The use of vegetative parts was found to be more common than the reproductive parts, and aerial parts were more commonly used than the underground parts. The leaf alone was the most commonly used plant part. The most common mode of preparation of the drugs was in the form of juice and paste, while the most common route of administration was either topical or oral. This is the relative frequency of the use of the different of these plants for treating different diseases, a total of 51 of them, and they were most commonly used to treat gastric problems, appetite loss, and cough and cold. These are some of the plants which are used to treat gastrointestinal problems, including treatment of intestinal worms, dysentery, gastric ulcers. These are some of the other plants which are used to treat also appetite loss, treatment of other gastric problems. These are plants used to treat pancreatic problems, mostly diabetes. This includes the use of the pseudo stem pith and flower of Musa sapientum. These plants are used for the treatment of jaundice and other liver problems. Most importantly, pediria foetida, which is boiled and taken with food. These are plants which are used for the treatment of asthma, including the seed paste of the two cardamoms, as well as the leaves of oxalis, the rhizome of curcuma, and the root of ananas commosus, that is pineapple. They were used for treatment of chest congestion. These are some more plants. These are used to treat cough and cold. Nyctanthus arbor tristis leaves are used for the treatment of fever, and gingiber officinal had a lot of uses. Cardiovascular problems involved the treatment of hypertension, again with the pseudo stem pith of Musa sapientum, as well as the bark decoction of terminalia. For kidney and urinary problems, especially for bladder and kidney stones, the leaf juice of Bryophyllum calycinum was reported. Several dental problems such as bad breath, toothache, and gum bleeding was also treated by these herbal remedies. These are some of the plants. A lot of skin problems, including the use of Barlaria lupulina, Blumea lacera, and Colocasia esculenta leaf latex, was done for the treatment of cuts and wounds. Skin itching was treated with Pisum sativum, skin burns with the tubers of Solanum tuberosum, and there are several other applications as well, such as treatment of ulcer and boils. Since this is a semi-urban region, animal bites are quite common, and the dry leaves of tobacco or the fresh leaves of alocasia and gossypium, they're used for the treatment of insect bites. Scorpion bites were treated with the fruit paste of capsicum, that is chili, and there was also the use of Clytoria ternacea root for the, as an antidote of snake bites was also reported. So from this data, you can see that the this community has been and still depend on traditional herbal remedies for their primary health care, primarily because of the reason that they are easily accessible, they are quite safe to use, and also there is not much improvement in the health infrastructure and availability of modern medicines. This knowledge and practice can be considered to be an intangible cultural heritage, and this is living because this data shows that it can adapt itself and evolve with the contemporary world by incorporating the uses of exotic plants, including two noxious exotic weeds. Thank you.
Respected dignitaries and all participants and students, a very good afternoon to you all. I am Dr. Sutapa Rai from Vivekananda College, Thakurpukur, Kolkata. I have carried out this research with two of my undergraduate students in the topic is the traditional herbal remedies used by the rural communities of Diamond Harbor in South 24 Parganas against gastrointestinal disorders. Next slide. Now, right in the beginning, what are gastrointestinal disorders? You all must be knowing. Any problems in the gastrointestinal tract leads to common problems like flatulence, that is gas formation, indigestion, loss of appetite, constipation, diarrhea, dysentery, nausea, vomiting, growth of intestinal worms, ulcer, and jaundice. And prolonged constipation can lead to piles and fistula, and prolonged diarrhea and vomiting may lead to fall in blood pressure, dehydration, electrolyte imbalance, vitamin deficiencies, and malnutrition. What is the present scenario in GI disorders? GI disorders are right at the top of the global disease burden, especially in the developing countries. In the Asian population, there is a rising of rapid increase in the rate of the GI disorders in the past two decades. India, which has a very poor sanitation conditions prevail in India, has a heavy toll taken by GI disorders every year. And diarrhea itself is the second largest cause of morbidity in rural India. Why should we go for herbal cures? As we all know that pharmaceuticals are rather expensive for the majority of the population of developing countries, whereas herbal remedies can be obtained from plants grown from seeds or collected from nature for little or no cost. Moreover, they have a high efficacy against a number of diseases. And last but not the least, they have hardly any serious side effects. This was our study area, Diamond Harbor area. We selected three villages based on the eagerness of the people to share their ethnobotanical knowledge. The villages chosen were Koyalpara, Raghunathpur, and Madhavpur. This was our method of survey. We went from door to door and people on the streets. We interviewed them in the local language and took down the names of the plants they used, particularly for GI disorders, and the mode of administration and the paths used. The graph shows, the green bar shows the total percentage of people who came out with the ethnobotanical data. You can see that 75% of the people belong to the age group 46 to 75, whereas only about 25% belong to the age group 26 to 45. This indicates that there is a decline in the use and traditional knowledge about the herbal remedies, which is rather sorry state of affairs. We recorded 45 plants belonging to 26 families, of which leguminosae and rutaceae had the most number of representatives, followed by apiaceae, ericaceae, and the others came next. The paths used in percentage, the fruits were most in use, followed by leaves, and then stem, whole plant, then came the root, the seed, and lastly the flowers. The use for different types of gastrointestinal disorders is recorded in the second pie chart. Stomach aches were most in use, then came the laxatives, then anti-dysenterics, then the anti-diarrheals, cure for piles and fistula, hepatoprotectives, and appetizers, anti-emetics, cure for carminatives, and jaundice. I have not covered all of the plants. I've chosen a few, and the names are according to plant list. These are some of the stomach aches which are in common use. Amaranthus viridis, the decoction of the plant is used as a stomach ache. Carica papaya, the fruit in cooked form, cures dyspepsia. Ginger rhizome juice is taken for dyspepsia. Coconut, green coconut water, as we all know, cures acid reflux, is a stomach coolant and digestive. Centella asiatica, the plant juice is taken orally as a stomach ache. A few more stomach aches. This is Coclospermum religiosum, the gum from the bark, is soaked in water overnight and drunk after stirring early in the morning in empty stomach. It's a very good stomach coolant. Piper beetle, very common to all of us, is chewed as a carminative and digestive. Lithia glutinosa, leaf juice is taken orally as a stomach coolant and also cures acidity. These are carminatives. Coriander leaves as well as the fruit is used as a carminative. Fruits of Phenoculum vulgare are taken raw as a carminative. Trachyspermum ammi or ajwain, the fruit is mixed with black salt and lemon juice, very tasty and chewed as a carminative. Citrus hystrix, the fruit juice is a very good carminative. These are appetizers, again coriander leaf, then Momordica carantia, the fruit juice or the cooked fruit, citrus hystrix and the rhizome juice of ginger. These are laxatives. Phoenix sylvestris fruit is taken as a laxative. The ripe fruit of Eagle marmelos is taken against constipation. Aloe vera leaf sap taken in empty stomach is a very good laxative. And Trifala with three fruits involved, that is Phyllanthus emblica, Terminalia bellarica and Terminalia chebula. The fruits are dried and the powder is mixed in the ratio 3:2:1, stirred in a cup of warm water and drunk 30 minutes before going to bed, serves as a very good laxative. These are antidiarrheals, the unripe fruit of Musa, the leaf juice of Pederia fetida, leaf juice of Neonamarchia kadamba, the unripe fruit of Eagle marmelos. Here you see the ripe fruit works against constipation. The unripe fruit cures diarrhea. They have some opposite effect. The rhizome of Curcuma longa also is taken for curing diarrhea. Antidysenterics include Eupatorium tripli nerve, decoction of the plant. Curcuma longa leaves are taken orally for cure of dysentery. Pederia fetida not only is an antidiarrheal, also works very well for chronic dysentery. Centella asiatica plant juice or even the leaf paste, if it's taken with steamed rice, it's very tasty also and is a very good antidysenteric. These are hepatoprotectives, Andrographis hispaniculata. 1 or 2 tablespoons of the plant decoction taken in empty stomach gives a healthy liver. Carica papaya fruit, cooked form, is a hepatoprotective. Cooked form of the plant Ipomia aquatica, plant juice of Centella asiatica, and cooked fruit of Moringa oleifera. Antihelminthics against intestinal worms include Andrographis paniculata, the deep leaf decoction or paste formed into leaf tablets is given in empty stomach. Hygrophila auriculata, leaf decoction and stem decoction. Limon Neolamarchia, leaf juice and Momordica, fruit juice or cooked fruit. Antiemetics for vomiting and nausea, the rhizome of ginger, the smelling the rind of Citrus orangifolia, fruit pulp of Feronia limonia with sugar and salt is very tasty and prevents vomiting. Coriandrum sativum leaf also helps. Cure for jaundice, Phyllanthus fraternus, Citrus maxima fruit, Saccharum officinarum stem juice taken 2 to 3 daily, and Cajanus Cajun leaf juice in empty stomach, taken regularly for 7 days, can cure jaundice, according to the people there. Cure for piles and fistula, as a director indica, unripe fruit, 3 to 4 taken daily, can cure piles. Paste of fruit and leaves of Mimosa pudica, aloe vera leaf sap, and the bark and leaf paste of cassia fistula can be applied on bleeding piles and fistula. Cure for ulcer, aloe vera leaf sap and Eupatorium triply nerve plant decoction helps to cure stomach and intestinal ulcers. In conclusion, you can see that rapid urbanization is leading to the decline in the use of easily available medicinal plants. Therefore, preservation of folklore should be given utmost importance to prevent rapid loss of this ethnobotanical wealth. Documenting the eroding plants and the indigenous knowledge associated with them could be the basis for developing management plans for their conservation and sustainable use. However, there is a ray of hope. Many pharmaceutical companies all over the world are taking interest in medicinal plants these days and funding researchers in this field. So I feel that if we all take, each of us take a step forward to create awareness among the people. I personally use these plants and I have found that they give very good results. For cough and cold, I have used Nyctanthus arborescens decoction and it helps a great deal. So, thank you, all of you, for listening to me patiently.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I would like to thank my teacher, Professor A.P. Das, who had taught me at the undergraduate level.
Yes.
And although I'm not a taxonomist, he has infused into me this interest in taxonomy and conservation.
Dear madam, taxonomy is most fascinating subject. I don't think there is
any other... I teach taxonomy.
Yes, please sit.
Out of interest.
Yeah, any questions? Let me comment on her presentation. Being a teacher, undergraduate teacher, with the help of students, she has collected enormous amount of data that is appreciable. And also, the photographs which she has included are far better than many of our photographs. I think I must congratulate and I appreciate your efforts.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you. I keep it up. And also, let me tell you, I will make use of this forum that we are organizing training programs for teachers in different places in the country, taxonomy training programs, wherein we teach all this, how to write the ethnobotanical paper and all that, taxonomic paper, how to present, some of these things and teachers like you, I think, should apply. In fact, advertisement has come in Current Science, in Resonance, in Academy website. You should try and apply. We are organizing three different places, one in North, two in North, one in South. We are
I'll try, sir.
Yeah, okay. Anyway, good luck
to you.
Thank you. Your students also.
Okay,
yes, thank you. Yes, okay.